Welcome to the Institute Presents. I'm Susan Rohn, the Executive Director, and today our co-host is Beverly Houck, the Artistic Director at the Institute. She hasn't been with us for a while. She's been very busy.
She's been on the road.
On the road is exactly where she's been. What were you doing? You were doing...
The summer library tour.
Summer library tour.
The Clumsy Dragon. We were in 25 libraries this summer with the Teen Theater Ensemble, and they rotated cast members. We had live music this year with guitarist Liza Gallen. Yep. And she's even started some music classes at the Institute now for very young children.
So that's she's a wonderful addition to the staff.
Yes, we've had
the music faculty. Mm-hmm. She really is. She's young and energetic and creative and easy to work with. And
we have other new faculty too. We have Garrett Solomon
that
just started last evening with theater.
He seems to be doing very well.
He is.
We should have brought him on here today.
I know, he's right across the street.
I thought about it last night, but I got overwhelmed with other things.
Well, we've had a few things to overwhelm us.
Yes, we have.
We've had
the groundbreaking for our new building, and we want to share that with you today. And the groundbreaking actually was Tuesday, September 12th. Mm-hmm. And everybody was invited, and we had quite a crowd, believe it or not, for a groundbreaking. And it was very successful. And we'd like to show you...
Well, this is a video of our space. I'll just get it started and we'll talk over it. This is very much our before space video. This is sort of the after party of the groundbreaking.
When they weren't supposed to be there.
But
they broke through and entered.
So anyone that's wondering what it looked like initially in there, that's where we are. It's just a little 360 around the big arch in the middle will be our main entrance. And there will be our performance space and gallery entrance. And for some strange reason, I went around in a circle and then decided to do the ceilings. So maybe we don't need to see all that. But this is our...
But the ceiling actually should show you the skylights.
I did. I walked over to see the skylights.
Yeah, the skylights add some beautiful light to the building.
Well, maybe not. Okay. So... the skylights are pretty exciting because they will be in the dance studios and the art studios, because if you look at the building from the outset, you go, oh my gosh, it's so much space, but nothing in the middle for light. Right. But these beautiful skylights.
Beautiful. They are. They really are.
I don't know if they're called skylights because they go up
they're
in the angle.
Else.
There's some special name for them.
There is a special name.
Lou Catellus.
Yes. Lou is the architect. Lou Muscati. In fact, he was photographed very well at the in the newspaper.
Yes, he was.
Yeah, and we have some pictures to share with you.
Oh, if I can get
from
them.
From groundbreaking.
Oh, give me a moment. I'm having trouble on this.
Okay.
I don't know why, but I am.
Can you focus in on it, or?
We'll see what happens. Okay, well, there's something with the view going on. If you can chat more about the groundbreaking, maybe the plans down here and such, while I try to get
this. This is what the building will look like when we're finished, we hope. this is the layout. And this will be the finished building. Now, the only thing different here is when you look at the white section in the middle, that roof is going to be raised. And that will be the entrance to the art gallery, which will enter to the theater, which will basically be a black box theater. Black ceiling, black, everything is black.
It sounds so terrible, but it's really not.
Great. It works beautifully. It will work beautifully.
Yes.
With light and flexible.
Right, and what's really exciting about that space is that it is a space that we really don't have going on. I got it. I did, finally. Thank you.
It's a space.
He's trying to not show, and I talked to him on the microphone. But we The Black Box Theater is something that we really don't have in our community. Kind of the closest thing we have to it right now is Francis Hall, that I'm aware of. There might be something I'm not aware of, is Francis Hall over at Alvernia. It's probably the most parallel if you're trying to imagine it. But there's no set stage area like there is at Francis Hall. So instead, it's going to be a big open box that we can use. We'll be using...
It's flexible.
Right. We'll be using risers, and sometimes it'll be for seating, and sometimes it'll be for the stage. And we might be able to have little acting areas to do things for very young audiences that are more interactive and have smaller groups travel from place to place. And it's very exciting, and hopefully we'll end up with around 200 seats in there at the maximum.
That's what we think.
Around 200.
Actually, wasn't Brett thinking apps? Maybe even 225.
Maybe even 225, which when I spoke to, we just started our Neighborhood Bridges program that you've heard us speak about. And when I was talking to a couple of the teachers there, they were very excited about the possibility of field trips there.
Great.
So it's pretty
and
wonderful.
At times it may be available to the community, depending.
Yes.
Depending on scheduling.
Yes.
But we would like it to become a community space, too.
Absolutely.
In many ways.
Mm-hmm. That we have a lot of stuff going on, we also have a few rehearsal areas, so we don't need to be in there all the time.
Mm-hmm. That's true. So it will serve. It'll be multi-purpose in that respect.
Right.
That you can use the rehearsal areas, or you can use the main theater.
And other exciting things about the space are we'll have three dance studios.
Mm-hmm.
All really nice sizes.
Yes.
We're going to have three art studios, where now we only have two, and kind of scheduling issues because of that. And our music wing is going to have a media sound lab that we'll be legging in over time. I don't think day one we'll have all the electronics needed, but we'll get there.
As time goes, yes. Money will become an object.
At some point.
A definite object, but the music, we are looking to build a really strong music area and a stronger music program.
Is it still in the plans that we'll have the larger area and be able to have a sound booth for recording?
Yes.
That's wonderful, and that's something that
I
would also be open.
Still here.
I thought it was the last time I saw it.
It's still there. We're not taking that out.
And then the other question with that is then that would be available to the community also, which is another thing that's kind of hard to find. So you musicians out there that are looking for a space to do recordings, you'll be able to talk to us in about a year or less.
In about a year. We should be moving in there by June 1, I would think. I hope.
Crossing fingers.
Or the end of May.
Depends on how rough the winter is.
Well, hopefully we have a good winter.
Well, here's some photos from the... Oh, never mind. She found that's the...
Okay, that's the layout.
For the theater.
Yes.
Yeah, that's the theater.
Yes.
And you have the other layout already scanned?
There,
great.
He has it right there.
So that shows a little bit more
and
of
that
it.
That shows you enter from where you see the blocks on the right. That's the front of the building. That's where you would enter.
And right now
see the pavers?
Right. Right now that's a big driveway, but we're turning it into an area with pavers and some foliage. I always say that weird
In fact,
word.
We'll also have 90 parking spaces plus...
Mm-hmm.
Which will be very helpful when we do productions or any recitals, concerts, whatever we do. And there will be, I don't know, do you have a picture of the parking lot, the whole area?
Here, put
okay,
it down.
I don't know.
Oh, whatever's easier for them.
I don't
here,
know if
sorry.
I can see.
I'll just hold it nice and still
there
for you.
There we go. This is great.
Oh, there you go. Yeah.
That's the building. This is Penn Avenue. So we're right on Penn Avenue, so there's a lot of high visibility. This is the parking area, the main building of the Yocum Institute, and then we have about 10,000 square feet that is open for rental. And we're looking at what we can put in there possibly, or at the very least we'll use it to grow, because we think we will. But we're looking for possibly a cafe.
I was just going to say, we're really hoping.
It's a built-in clientele.
We're hoping for a little cafe. We're hoping for a little cafe that runs later in the evening as well as early morning, because we have our preschool drop-off and our classes and parents that drop off their kids and want a place to go and sit. So if you're out there.
It's a great opportunity if you're looking for a place to open a cafe.
Here's our pitch.
Or else
cafe.
We may be opening a cafe.
I keep saying a Keurig and a little jar for dollars, a nice comfy couch, and we're all set.
Could be.
Here are some photos from our from the opening. Well, Susan, why don't you explain who it is, including yourself?
Well, basically, it is the committee. And basically, the committee and the donors who have made this portion of it possible. And you see Bill Wellock on the end here on the left. And he has really been a driving force in making sure everything's done according to plan and developing the plan and working with engineers and lawyers and everybody else. He's been excellent. And then next to him is Mr. Yocum, James H. Yocum.
With his new sunglasses.
With his new sunglasses. And he is just been a fabulous, fabulous person to the Institute and the community in many ways. We owe a lot to Mr. Yocum, and we are named the Yocum Institute. He has made sure that there is something in this community to foster creativity and the beginning of the story of the arts. Next to him is our president, Jenny Pacroduni, who has been wonderful also. And next to her is Chris Leupold. Chris is the treasurer of the board, and he has done tons of work with the banks especially. We wouldn't be doing this without him. And then next to him is Margaret Schumo, Peg Schumo. Peg is the person that made it possible for us to actually get the building. She showed up the day of the auction, and we went as high as we were allowed to go.
Here she is
and,
again.
Here she is again, and she bid until she got it and made up the difference between what we could do and what we got the building for. Plus, she is naming the theater. It's the Schumo Theater, and she has made a generous contribution to name the theater. We still have a long way to go naming and raising money, so the man on the end is Nick Bentley, and Nick is co-chair with his wife, Amy Lipton, of the building campaign, and I am next to him.
Being Susan.
Were sharing a shovel. Because I wore a dress, because I had a meeting that morning.
And here's Bill Wellock.
And here's Bill and Steve from Berkey. Berkey Construction's in charge of the project.
And
they have been wonderful to deal with.
And Matt.
Matt, and I guess it's Eric.
It's Eric, the back of Eric's head. Yeah. But he has the Berkey Construction hat, so we know who it is.
And here we have other people attending, Mary Palmer.
This is Bill and the architect,
Lou.
And
here we have...
And I snuck in this picture because...
It was fun. And I look like I'm crazy.
And we had a handful of families that were at the event, which was wonderful. And we very quickly said, you need to be at the groundbreaking too, because you are the future of the Institute. And we actually have some representatives from our dance program, our theater program, our preschool and visual arts, and someone who's looking to start taking classes at the Institute because of all this. So that was really neat to have. And this shows you we had a lot of people there. That was wonderful.
We did. We just didn't know how many to expect. We figured maybe if 20 show up, but I think we got 60.
Susan made me keep this photo in.
I love this one. This is Beverly, Chris, and my husband even came to this one.
And I'll give a quick shout-out, compliments of my mother-in-law, who grabbed the camera from me and made sure I was in a photo.
I'm glad she did.
Here's another view looking out of our new space. This is actually, I think, our cover photo on our Facebook page right now, too.
This is Peg and her friend Bill and her daughter Cindy, who is going to help us with the steering committee.
And Jenny.
And Jenny, president, and the campaign chair, and me.
And this was just getting set up at the beginning. Representatives from the
Berks Art Alliance, exactly.
Because we hope to continue
Diana,
our relationship with
Tony
them.
Tony Kleiner.
Here's
and
Kent
here
Davis.
We have Kent Davis, who has past president of the board.
In case you missed Mr. Yocum and his splendorous new sunglasses and Peg Schumo and her sunglasses, we have another close-up. They kind of look a little bit like movie stars there.
They do look like movie stars, don't they?
Yes. Well, and this is Tammy Up to Grove. Who is, we decided she needed to play in the dirt because she's one of our art teachers getting us ready for playtime. And David Edgar Guest from our front desk and from backstage here on BCTV, yes. And Mr. Yocum. And just a wide shot of some of the space. And actually everyone right now is standing in what will be our theater space. And that's what we have in terms of photos for that.
Yes, but we hope you join us when we move and we will keep you updated.
And we hope to have a nice big open house with activities.
We will. Things. Absolutely. We will have a big open house and invite the community.
It's your center, folks.
Yeah, that's right. Yes. And it's in a nice, it's in West Lawn. It's right on Penn Avenue, 3000 Penn Avenue. And we've had a lot of interest even from students going by saying, what's going to be here? We tell them an art center and they go, an art center? Oh my goodness.
They're very excited.
They're really excited about it. So are we. So we're wishing ourselves luck and ask for your support in this momentous project.
Susan, we've been together through a lot.
I know.
Because we started Primary Stages, the whole program together, and now here we are.
And on to Primary Stages.
Oh, yes. I didn't even realize I was giving myself
production,
a segue.
Right. Production coming up in October.
Yes, we have Art Dog coming in October. I think we have a little visual of the book it was based on. Art Dog tells the story of Arthur, who by day is a museum guard, and by night he is known as Art Dog. And it's a wonderful adaptation. It's musical, and we'll be doing it in a somewhat vaudevillian style with kind of everything happening on stage. At the moment, we still have planned a three-piece orchestra, our trio, doing live music, and it'll be at the Miller Center on the 27th. And
Friday night.
Mm-hmm. Did I get the dates right?
Yes.
27th and 28th.
Yes.
Tickets are available. And on Saturday, Tammy, who you saw playing in the mud back there, she is going to be leading an art project. And she and Nadia Perfect Resnick are going to be creating the set, which is really fun.
I think it would be.
The set is because you have the museum and you have paintings that talk to him and, well, they don't really talk to him, but they move. And the Mona Wolfa is stolen. It takes place in Dogopolis, so everyone's a dog. We're not going to be doing masks or anything like that, but we will have, humanized dogs. Is that something?
Who's doing the costume?
Oh, Becca. Becca's doing the costume. She already has tons of ideas, of course. Becca's really grown into being our resident costumer, and she does a great.
She's great.
Yep, and she's excited about having space for costumes in a shop.
Oh, yes, we have a lower level in the new building of 10,000 square feet.
That'll basically be storage and a costume shop, which
and
is what we really
room.
And, and possibly
and
a conference
office,
room,
possibly.
A kiln area.
Right. Yeah, I'm going to burn the place. Never mind.
One of my students in the teen ensemble last night when we met, they said about how one of the things that they always like about the Institute where it is now is that every room you go in and every time you walk by, there's like 10 things happening. And that how we repurpose the rooms to be used however they need to be used, and that it'll be actually a little strange to have a studio that's really just for art rather than art and
theater
and
music
and
multi-purpose rooms, which aren't bad. But
no, it's great, and I can't imagine that we'll still have all the disciplines working together. So
sure, we will.
But it's exciting.
Well, there's another production coming up too in November over Thanksgiving weekend.
Yes, Visions of Sugar Plums, which I'm directing, and Anne Burkott and Nina Ballester are choreographing. Mm-hmm. And it's really a piece, instead of doing the Nutcracker Twist this year, we took the Nutcracker Twist and our Primary Stages holiday show that we've been doing for the last 11 years or something like that, 12 years?
2005. I think.
2005 was our first one. So we took those together and we put it all under the Primary Stages umbrella. And by doing that, we have dancers from our dance students as well as other members from the community and students, and primarily it's kind of like Broadway Junior in
who's in the show, mm-hmm. that it's all young people, but the show is written for children to be the performers. Mm-hmm. So it's not like you have someone playing a grandmother. We'll have an actual person playing a grandmother of closer to that age, maybe not quite that age, but closer to that age. We'll have maybe another adult or two, but it's written and it's going to be a great journey and fun, and we're excited.
And who wrote this?
Myself with the assistance of Michelle Fogel.
Okay.
I am curious. Not taking full credit. She did a lot.
But it'll be a great kickoff to the holidays.
It will be a great kickoff to the holidays. It's mm-hmm. really, really,
and
really
it's Thanksgiving
fun.
Weekend. And
right. So the show is Saturday and Sunday over Thanksgiving weekend at 3 o'clock and 7 o'clock on Saturday, and 3 o'clock on Sunday. So hopefully if you have family in town for the weekend and you're looking for something to do, it'll be fun.
How many are in the cast?
30 maybe?
30?
Somewhere around 30.
How many dancers do you know?
Oh, well, some of the actors that play the children are also dancers.
Dancers, okay.
So, and we got lucky that some of them are strong dancers.
That's terrific.
So there's a core of, I want to say 18 dancers or something mm-hmm. like that. I might be making up numbers, so.
That's okay.
It's all right. It's only on posterity.
Come and see it, you'll see.
And Becca's doing the costumes again, and Nadia's doing the set for that.
So that's an exciting Thanksgiving weekend.
And we're hoping to make it snow.
Oh, good. Maybe it'll really snow.
No. Just snow.
That
just snow for fun.
Yeah. Well, moving on from productions, we have a very interesting exhibit going on right now. It's called Make Art Great Again. Right, left, and in between. And
yes.
It has been a very interesting
interactive experience.
Exactly. It was probably one of the most packed exhibit openings I've seen in a long time.
Yes.
There were at least 100, 110 people there, I would think.
And here are some images of the opening that we have available for you. These are some people looking at Dave Nally's work, right. Who's extreme left.
More to the left.
Oh no, he's kind of extreme to the
left.
He's
extreme.
He's
okay.
self-promoted extreme right. to the left. And then over here we have some people looking at Vicky Rodier, who is self-proclaimed more to the
she's conservative.
Right. Yep.
And she's we tried to get her to come on today to talk about her work because some of it is just hilarious.
Yep. This is a Dave Nally piece if you're not familiar with his work. We do have some images on our Facebook page. That has a little more taste. But as you can see, the exhibit was not just drawings or paintings, but it had some three-dimensional work as well, the little puppets hanging there. And it included, how many different artists? Like 10? 10 or more than
yeah,
that?
Yeah, it was primarily the work of Vicky Rodier and Dave Nally. That's how it started.
Mm-hmm.
But then we decided, you know, you've got the fairly conservative and the extreme left, so the big thing today is let's start talking to each other. Mm-hmm. There's middle ground, too. So we had a number of people in the middle.
And a conversation that happened right here with, I'm sorry.
Yes, and then Arthur Naylor and Lynn Millar, who were on this show last month with me, came and did a presentation on Fair Berks.
Mm-hmm.
And it's about redistricting, and it's about giving things back to the people instead of the politicians. And there was a real reason for this show, and the show was that we needed to start communicating, and you certainly need to start doing that. If you can't do that with the arts, then how can you do it? And Beverly has a
quote that I didn't
a
bring
a quote
along.
That you didn't bring. Oh, okay.
It's by Eric Erickson, who was the founder of Teaching Artists and the Idea. And basically the idea of the quote was that, you know, we're in a society where nouns become more prevalent, but verbs are what create change. And that through the arts, it gives us a platform for discussion and for collaboration and communication.
And connection.
And there was a lot of that night.
There was a lot of that despite the diverse group there. And they were from all over. And they were had all different political views, but they all really got along very well.
And they laughed together.
And they laughed and they had a good time. And even if you didn't particularly buy into the viewpoint of the art, you could appreciate the approach that was taken. And I think that was a significant thing about the arts. It transferred. You can look at it and say, this is well done. I may not agree with
it.
Or look at, this is a different approach to looking at something. And I think that's what it created.
And the majority of the pieces were very fine work.
I mean, a
couple of them were more statement pieces or, you know, they put something together because they wanted to really talk on this topic or speak to that topic. But the majority of them are very, very fine works. Several pieces sold, and it was a lot of good communication and people talking with people that maybe they wouldn't have otherwise.
Exactly. They were all kind of thrown together in a space that became small after a while because there were so many people bumping into each other. But if you get the opportunity, it's here until November 4th. It closes on the 4th of November. And please feel free to stop by and see it. And after that, we have another show coming. We're not sure of the time. I think it's Small Works. And it'll be a show for the holidays so that people can come in and buy small works of art or small prices for art. And that's basically the gist of it. And that will open around, I think, the 9th or the 10th of November, somewhere in there.
And also in November we have
the Coggins Award, and Regina Miller will be getting the Coggins Award this year. And that is November 7th, and it's at Sterling Guest Hotel. And for tickets, you may call the Institute.
Yep.
And that about does it with all the things we have discussed.
Except
but what else?
What else is that our fall classes just started.
Fall classes started. Yes.
By the way,
in
the middle of all this, we started our fall classes.
That's why we're here, for classes.
And there is still an opportunity to certainly sign up for our ongoing dance classes. We have other classes that really just started this week. So if you're seeing this program, today's the 15th, I think. Today's the 15th. So we've just completed our first week. So if you're seeing this very soon, you could certainly still join in on the classes, and we'll have mini session coming then as well.
Yeah, mini session is always interesting because it's only 3 to 5 weeks.
5 weeks this year.
And it has, depending on how long the teacher, you know, the workshop or whatever it is they have. And it gives you a taste of it. Mm-hmm. So you can try something that maybe you weren't sure you really would like, but you're not locked in for 10 weeks or whatever.
And I think in visual arts, they're planning to have more things that allow you to create something, like kind of a takeaway something, especially for some of the adults. We do a lot of focus on children's programs, but we're, especially with our new space, we'll be developing more things for adults and seniors and things like that.
Yes, the new
seniors
space
are adults too. I better be careful there.
Seniors, adults, disabilities,
yeah.
Because this is a street level program.
Yep.
So I'm a street level building. This has been fun. It's gone by very quickly. And I think we have to stop talking and say goodbye. Thank you for joining us. We'll see you next month.